You watch the beachgoers from your surfboard like ants on a strip of gold against a blue sky. Something catches your eye. A looming shadow lurks below your dangling feet. You pull your legs up onto your board and watch as the creature courses through the water, its massive black silhouette betraying its size. You paddle back to shore in a panic, the slapping sound of hands on water small in the din of sloshing ocean waves. Sweat, or seawater, you can't tell which, pours down your forehead, burning your eyes, and turning the world to a blurry vignette. You brush the water from your eyes, but to no avail. Before you can even scream, a giant mouth rushes out from below the waves. A cavernous maw, lined with thousands of teeth, swallows you whole. Could the Megalodon still prowl along the darkest depths of our oceans? Thanks to this video sponsor, Bloodline Heroes of Lithis, new legends will be born in this fantasy online hero collector role-playing game where you play as the guardian of the City of Light, defending and restoring it to its rightful glory. Bloodline has incredible 3D graphics with easy controls on a vertical screen, so there's nothing in the way between you and the fun. The game is all about marrying champions into different bloodlines to make stronger heirs for your kingdom. You can select from dozens of traits to customize and create unique combinations of 5 powerful abilities to aid you in battle. And it's free to play on both Android and iOS. Use my link now to get the Karg clan of Dragonborn for free. Other families include Lycanus, a must-try family of werewolves for you to play with. The Fulgur clan of demigods. Generally, mages are damage dealers, but their leader buffs himself, casts area of effect spells, and can even shield allies. You can even have dragonborn demigod hybrids. Keep developing your family tree until your champion has the best traits from their parents. Choose your path in Bloodline Heroes of Lithis today. Click the link in the description or scan the QR code. Use our promo code BLDHOL2 to get 20 intimacy packs, 100,000 gold, and 100 diamonds totally free. The ocean is big. Conservative estimates believe we've only seen about 20% of it. And it's long been a feature of our collective consciousness to see monsters stalking in the briny depths. It wasn't until 2003 that we got our first photograph of a giant squid. So, couldn't it be possible, nay, probable, that there are other sea monsters down there? Perhaps even something prehistoric.
What? Like you?
In the 2018 film The Meg, billionaire Jack Morris, played by Rainn Wilson, funds an expedition to the bottom of the Mariana Trench, the deepest point on Earth, where they discover a false bottom hiding an underground haven for prehistoric flora and fauna. In doing so, they release one of the Earth's greatest predators from its underwater prison, the Megalodon. You might have heard of the Megalodon before. The idea of an ancient sea monster, still roaming the ebb and flow of our world's oceans, tickles our imagination in a wonderful way. But that's just a movie. It's not like the Megalodon could still be alive down in the depths of the seven seas, right? Right? Megalodon is a, hopefully, extinct member of the shark species. Scientifically known as Carcharocles megalodon, considered to not only be the largest shark that has ever existed, but the largest fish full stop. We know this primarily from the absolutely enormous fossilized teeth we've found scattered along the shorelines of the world. Even its name, megalodon, comes from the Greek word for big, megalos, and the word for tooth, odon. The shark lived in the early Miocene epoch, about 23 million years ago, until the end of the Pliocene epoch, about 2.5 million years ago. In this period, there was a waterway connecting the Atlantic and Pacific Oceans, and another between the Atlantic and Indian Oceans, which lent itself to the megalodon's widespread distribution across the planet. By all accounts, it was a very good shark, having topped the oceanic food chain for 21 million years. Compared to humans, we look like tiny babies who have only been around for 300,000 years max. When we first discovered fossils of the megalodon, we initially thought that it must be related to our own waterborne apex predator, the great white shark. But as modern science advanced, we learned that this ancient mega predator is a closer relative of the mako shark. We thought great whites were related to megalodon because of their teeth shape. They were the exact same shape, just massive. One of the main issues paleontologists had at first was that the only fossils we could find were their teeth, because the majority of sharks' bodies are made out of cartilage, the stuff your ears and nose are made of, which decomposes pretty easily and is rarely fossilized. It also took us 20 years to recreate a megalodon jaw in full. But granted, it's an absolutely enormous jaw, sitting at about 11 feet wide and 9 feet tall. Shark teeth are made out of a material called calcium phosphate, which is super hard and, lucky for us, fossilizes like a snap. Luckier for us, sharks, much like we shed hair and clip our nails, constantly shed and regrow rows upon rows of razor-sharp teeth for their entire lives. We figured that Megalodon also regrew teeth throughout its life because of the amount of giant teeth we've found littering the seafloor. We extrapolated the monster's size from the size of their teeth and a handful of vertebrae, a portion of their spine. Our estimates say that they were, on average, over 10 meters long, and weighed anywhere between 30 and 65 tons. The largest specimen ever found was thought to be around 18 meters long. For context, a full-size school bus is only 14 meters long, and the blue whale, the literal largest creature to ever exist on Earth, is only about 2 times longer than this mega shark. Thanks, I hate it! To compare, adult great white sharks only grow to a maximum size of about 6.5 meters and only weigh, between 520 and 770 kilos. That is, less than a single metric ton. Thanks, it's worse now. Megalodon, much like the great white, give birth to live young. We're not sure if they're viviparous, where live embryos derive nutrients from their mother like us, or oviviparous, where eggs live inside the mother until they hatch. One way or another, there's some gigantic babies, measuring at least 2 meters long at birth. In terms of what they eat, they preyed on whales, seals, and sea cows. Young megalodons likely went after smaller prey, and were preyed upon themselves, while the adults were likely apex predators. Now, the thing that allowed the megalodon to climb up the food chain wasn't necessarily their rows upon rows of razor-sharp teeth or their incredible size, but a quality of their heart. No, I'm not talking about the power of friendship, but the power of exothermic reactions. It doesn't roll off the tongue as well. Most fish and sharks are cold-blooded, aka ectothermic, meaning that their body temperatures fluctuate according to the temperature of their surroundings. But Megalodon and the Great White Shark too are endothermic, meaning that they produce their own heat. This allowed the Megalodon to hunt in colder environments than their cold-blooded counterparts, giving them exclusive feeding rights to certain places. Most times in nature, it's the mundane abilities that guarantee the success or extinction of your entire species. The question remains, is it possible that the Megalodon still exists today? Hidden in the vast depths of the ocean. In the movie The Meg, scientists discover an unexplored cavern underneath the Mariana Trench, hidden by what they call a thermocline layer of hydrogen sulfide, and this deeper section of the trench is much warmer than the water above, allowing the megalodon to continue its clandestine existence below the waves. In reality, sea creatures that come to the sunlit surface levels of the ocean cannot survive the cold or the intense pressures of the deep ocean. But is it really possible for sharks to live at the bottom of the ocean? Surprise, they can! There are many shark species that can live in the deeper ocean, but the shark we've found deepest is the frilled shark. Predominantly a deep water animal, the frilled shark lives close to the seabed at depths of around 1.5 kilometers. For context, the average depth of the ocean is about 3.7 kilometers. The frilled shark has existed in basically the same form for millions of years. Living at such depths, they've adapted perfectly for the deep sea environment, preventing marine biologists from observing many in the wild. They're about 2 meters long, and judging by their stomach contents, eat squid and some fish. This is a far cry from the megalodon, but it does bode well for the idea that our prehistoric apex predator could still live somewhere down there. If the frilled shark can exist virtually unchanged, the megalodon could too, right? Why am I trying to prove this right? Sharks that live at the bottom of the ocean don't actually look much like the Megalodon. Just like the movie, with a warm cavern under the Mariana Trench, warm spots can exist at the bottom of the ocean. For example, Kavachi Volcano, a large underwater volcano in the Solomon Sea south of Vangunu Island, erupted in January 2015, leaving a plume of smoke floating through the ocean visible from space. The base of the volcano sits over a kilometer below the surface and erupts regularly. But that's not what makes this place so crazy. No, what makes this volcano better than all the other volcanoes is that this volcano has sharks living in it. Yep, that's right. It's a gosh darn tootin' Sharkcano. Whew. Two species of shark live in the crater. Silky and scalloped hammerhead sharks, alongside jellies and small fish. The water down there is superheated and infused with sulfur, which allows some creatures that would otherwise be unable to live so deep survive in such cold water. It also provides ample opportunities for researchers interested in how climate change may affect biodiversity. How do sea creatures adapt to this high sulfur environment? And how might that educate us on our rapidly changing Earth? That said, the Mariana Trench is 11 kilometers under the surface, so Kavachi, sitting only 1 kilometer below the waves, is a far cry from our movie Megalodon. While underwater spaces are capable of providing a more hospitable environment for our Pliocene predator, there are still a few loose ends. Firstly, in the movie The Meg, scientists find a thermocline at the bottom of the Mariana Trench that separates the cold deep ocean from a warmer pocket heated by geothermal vents. But the science behind this is dubious. A thermocline is a layer of water in which temperatures rapidly drop. Clines come in all shapes and sizes, but they're just horizontal layers in liquid that separates two states of a liquid. There are many layers in the ocean. You can see all their names here, with the power of technology. The top layer, the epipelagic zone, or the sunlight zone, is separated with a thermocline right below it in the mesopelagic zone, or the twilight zone. As the sun's light dims, the temperature drops. It's kind of like when you swim in a lake and suddenly you find a cold spot. You've dipped your toes into a thermocline. Thermoclines aren't like caps that hold heat in. They're just what happens when you have warm water above mixing with cold water below. However, the thermocline in the movie was composed of hydrogen sulfide, which does actually exist. In Mexico's Yucatan Peninsula, they have many natural sinkholes called cenotes. In at least one of these sinkholes, there is a freshwater pool on top, separated from a saltwater river below by a thick 3-meter layer of toxic hydrogen sulfide. It was formed when organic matter fell into the sinkhole, rotted, and the chemicals that came off during decomposition congealed into a toxic hydrogen sulfide layer. This layer, called a halocline, can prevent debris from passing from the freshwater top to the saltwater bottom, just like in the movie. It's due to the difference in density between fresh and saltwater. Imagine oil and water in a beaker. If you stir it up, it'll all mix together. But sitting still, it'll separate out. And the water in a cenote does nothing but sit still. This actually bodes well for the science of the movie, since it's nearly impossible for animal life to pass through the layer unpoisoned, especially if it uses gills to filter oxygen out of the water around it. Even human divers with oxygen tanks shouldn't spend too much time immersed in this toxic cloud. So, conceivably, there could be a layer of hydrogen sulfide somewhere at the bottom of the ocean in a place like the Mariana Trench, which could prevent sea life from moving from one layer of the ocean to another. But unless you have a very specific set of circumstances, it's unlikely to exist. With all that said, we should probably poke around the bottom of the Mariana Trench to see for ourselves if there's anything crazy going on down there. Thermoclines and underwater volcanoes don't appear that often below certain depths. The deepest warm spots like hydrothermal vents and underwater volcanoes we've found were only 5 kilometers below the water, only halfway down to the deepest parts of the Mariana Trench where our movie Meg lived for millions of years. Lucky for us, James Cameron has an interest in the bottom of the ocean. In 2012, the Titanic and Avatar director ventured to the bottom of the Mariana Trench in an event called Deepsea Challenge. Squeezing himself into a pilot sphere that was so small that he couldn't raise his arms above his head, he ventured down 11 kilometers, actually touching the bottom of the deepest part of the trench, Challenger Deep, which unfortunately debunks our false bottom thermocline from the movie. So while the idea of a thermocline hiding a cavern of megalodon supporting warmth at the bottom of the Mariana Trench might be bunk, does that mean it can't be floating around at the bottom of the ocean? Anything that lurks down at the bottom of the ocean would have to adapt to survive the incredible water pressure exerted on everything that deep. This is also why only James Cameron has seen the bottom. It's a death trap down there that we've only just figured out how to live through. Animals living down there would need to not only survive, but thrive under pressures reaching 15,000 pounds per square inch. For example, a car crusher at a junkyard only exerts 2,000 psi of pressure. At those levels, animals don't get too large, though there are some exceptions, which we've talked about on previous Brew episodes. Actual giant creatures do live in the deep ocean, but unfortunately, or fortunately, none so large as the megalodon and none so deep as the Mariana Trench. For example, giant squid, some of our abyssal nightmares, only live 1 to 2 kilometers under the surface. Sperm whales, whose ancestors would have been some of the megalodon's prime rib, are known to dive into the deep abyss, but only about 2 kilometers down, 3 max. This serves to illustrate 2 points. First, if the megalodon were to live down there for the 2.5 million years since we think it went extinct, it would have evolved to look much more like the deep sea sharks we've seen, and likely have become much, much smaller. Second, if the megalodon were to live down there, it would need to eat. And since creatures that can survive in those depths are quite small, it's almost impossible for it to have gotten the calories it needed to survive. A great white eats about 0.5 to 3% of their total body weight each time they hunt, which is about 15 to 20 kilograms each. If a megalodon were to need the same intake, on the low end, it would need somewhere above 1,983 kilograms each hunt. We don't know exactly how much megalodon ate, and most of our estimates on great white intake are also educated guesses, but the point being, the Meg needs a metric buttload of food to survive. It would be impossible for even a great white shark, which we know to be far smaller than the megalodon, to survive on the measly scraps you'd find at the bottom of the ocean. An animal as large as the megalodon would have to leave some trace of its existence. The most recent megalodon teeth we've found so far are still dated to 2.6 million years ago. Like we learned earlier, sharks have rows upon rows of teeth. They're constantly losing them, and they're easily fossilized. So, if there were live megalodons splashing around in our oceans, we would have definitely found teeth younger than 2.5 million years old, fossilized or not. The ocean is large, and humans have navigated basically all of it. That is, at least the top bits. Still, we've found no sign of any mythical or prehistoric sea monsters out there. Just the regular ones. You know, your giant squid and your blue whales. In the age of exploration, we learned that dragons weren't lurking just beneath the waves, waiting for the perfect opportunity to drag boats down to their murky deaths, but that doesn't mean that there aren't more creatures to discover in the darkest corners of this beautiful earth. But hey, maybe all the megalodons are just hiding their teeth in a cave somewhere so they can maintain the element of surprise. But until then, it seems that this particular sea monster will remain in prehistory, where it belongs. Just remember to stay curious, and just because this monster isn't around anymore, doesn't mean that there aren't more out there for us to find. Just don't ask me to go out there with you to find them. Okay, to end the video, I have a joke for you. What do you call a shark that's rude on purpose? The Neg-a-ladon. Click the link in the description and choose your path in Bloodline Heroes of Lithis today.